It's really a pleasure to be here today. I really am glad that you came, and I'm thrilled to be here too. So today I'm going to talk about some of the requirements that interactive services impose on performance. And interactive services, I mean things like search, ads, games, finance. And then I'm going to discuss how you measure tail latency and discover what the problems are, and then some optimizations that help you improve once you've discovered what the problems are. And let's start by, and I'm going to start with interesting landscape of where we are in cloud computing right now from a recent report from the Department of Energy statistics from the U.S. about data centers and cloud. And so what's in the cloud are data centers. And so that's a picture of one of Microsoft's Quincy data center, and that has a ton of networking and a ton of servers in them. And they consume energy, and it takes money to build these things. And so how many servers are in there? Well, in the U.S. data centers, they're currently from public data sources, and the companies are required to tell the U.S. government where they're putting data centers and some of their plans. And so this is and what's in the servers. What kind of servers they're buying and building. And this is pretty interesting in terms of the penetration of specialization already, which is that blue part up there. So an unbranded server is something where you may have bought some of the parts, but you custom designed some of them when you were making the data center for your particular workload. And we see that already there's already some customization in that blue part, and that's expected to grow. And then a branded one socket machine is a smaller server than a branded two socket. And branded means you're buying it from ARM or from Intel or one of the manufacturers, and you may have asked them to do something special, but you didn't do that special thing yourself. All right, so we've got about 14 million servers. And then once you've installed them, they consume energy. And this is very interesting, in fact. This also is a positive for our community. If you had gone on the 2010 trend, where we were consuming more and more energy every single day in data centers, you can see we flattened out quite a bit. And then there, all those dotted lines are different predictions in terms of improving energy efficiency in the data center. So on the y-axis is the billions of kilowatt hours per year from the installed data sets. And for this data, it's precise until 2014 in terms of they're using records to compute it, although they still have to do some prediction and estimation about what from the information they have. But all the things past 2014 are predictions based on what on several models that develop, and so they identify just some better technology if we just go on that trend that we can stay flat. So even though we're going to put more and more servers into the data centers, we're going to build more data centers, the energy's going to be flat if we continue on these trends of making the servers more energy efficient. So hardware people working on that, good job. And you software people who are combining hardware and software techniques to do while the software is running, you're being relied on there. And then one of the key things this report identifies is that the dual socket big machines are much more energy efficiency. So they're recommending they're doing recommendations for the U.S. government. What kind of service does the U.S. government? Well, they should be buying bigger machines rather than smaller one-socket machines. And then best practices, and then if you put all those things together, you could get on this orange line, and we could actually really decrease the number of amount of energy that we're spending to keep these data centers doing all this computation for us. And then if you translate billion of kilowatt hours from electricity into dollars, you get a range of potential prices. It can be $1 to $6 billion because of different prices for energy that and different markets for the energy. So putting that together a little bit, we have the cost of one data center is about $500,000 to build one data center, and that can vary widely, so that's just an average cost. And then there are about 3 million data centers right now in the U.S., and $1.5 trillion capital investment to date to build those data centers, all right? And then to operate them, we've got $3.5 billion of energy. So one thing we can do is we can make every single data center more energy efficient or do less work by doing compiler optimizations or other software optimizations because it's already installed there. And that's a lot of money if we can do that in every single data center. And so the providers who are doing this, like Microsoft, Facebook, Google, they all want to make their software more energy efficient, and that's saving them. And there was some back of the envelope calculation about Facebook that every 1% of efficiency and performance or just energy efficiency translates into $1 to $4 million a year for them. So the big players in this also have non-trivial operational costs. But of course, if you never have to build that data center in the first place and never give it any power, that's even more powerful. So if your software can do consolidation and run more and more of your workload on fewer servers, that's a better way to optimize too. All right, so that motivates improving efficiency if you didn't believe it, and the performance is still king in the data center. All right, now on the other end is that human being and asking the cloud to do stuff for us. And the tail latency that that human being experiences determines if they're going to use the service or not. So Google and Microsoft have both published an interesting number on search, and I'm going to use search as my example for the majority of this talk. So 400 milliseconds delay decreased searches per user by 0.59%. So that doesn't seem like very much, but if you're not searching, you can't click on ads, you can't serve ads, Google can't make any money. And Bing, and this is an old number, so this was before Bing was even had as much penetration for its search service, a 2-second slowdown, one, two, all that took was revenue per user went down by over 4%. So if you're not getting a response to the users in a really as quickly as you possibly can, then you cannot make the kind of money that you need to. And the reason really is that people will abandon your service completely if they don't feel like it's responsive. So we've all been trained to, we put it in and it doesn't come back right away and we're irritated and impatient, and that translates into abandoning these services. So that is our top priority, because if people aren't using our services, then we won't build any data centers anyway. So these, once you realize this and you're trying to build a new service or an existing service, you have to highly engineer it. And the tail, as I'll discuss in a little more detail in a moment, the tail latency means worst case performance. And the reason it's worst case performance is because when you're sending in search, the main example I'm going to use, when you send a request to search, it doesn't just go to one machine, it goes to hundreds of machines. And if each machine has a 1% worst case, when you're going to 100 machines, you increase the worst case at the user end if it has to wait for everybody, because you're definitely going to get worst case from one of those machines. So you have to do something in order to keep that worst case as small as possible. So So Lucene is an open source search engine used for Wikipedia and a bunch of other services, and it's in the public domain, and so I'm going to use data from it to an analysis of it, because it can be open and you can download it and you can use it too. So this was work done with my colleagues at ANU University, and so we needed an open source platform to work on it. This is just a basic search engine that has a lot of the features that the good search engines have, but not all of them, because it's not as highly engineered. It's an open source product. So here I'm showing on the y-axis the percent of requests and their latency. And so, but we have shown that this has many characteristics that are similar to Bing. So one of the things you need to know about these systems is they're bursty and diurnal. So day-to-day patterns matter, and you have bursts, and when people get up in the morning and do a search, you get a bunch more searches. When people go to bed, you get fewer. But even during the day, when you have a relatively constant number of people using the service, everybody can search all at once randomly. So you have to provision for the worst case. You have to be able to handle a big burst of load that's orders of magnitude higher than your average load. And then this cumulative distribution function for a service changes slowly over time. And so what does that mean? That means that most of your queries are short, a few are long, but each one has a lot of variation, and you can't predict how long one's request might take. But that shape of the curve is something that you can use to help optimize and make optimization choices. And then, unfortunately, the slowest server in here dictates the tail. So these over at 100 milliseconds for this service, there are problem children that we need to work on. And then there's usually an order of magnitude difference between the tail and the average or the short requests. And this is actually the difference between these two is actually less than what we see in bigger deployed systems. All right, so what's in that tail? Well, if what's in that tail is just noise, because sometimes the machine goes down, or your network isn't behaving properly, or you hit some side condition in the operating system, or you can treat it as noise, even if it has a systematic cause that you haven't been able to figure out yet, but it acts randomly enough that you can treat it as noise, there's good theoretical results on replication. And that says, send it to at least two servers at the same time, or two systems. In the case of search, you would send it to two different index serves. And then you get rid of that noise, because one of them will come back fast enough, and that's the response you can use, and you can throw the others away. And so that's great, but that flies in the face of what I said earlier in the talk, which is we want to be efficient. And so sending it all the time to two big systems would be very inefficient. So that cumulative distribution function tells you how to do that, actually. So if you want to only have your worst case latency be 40%, and you think that most of the things over 40% are noise, then you could, after that, you could send 10% of requests you could duplicate after 40 microseconds, and then at 80 microseconds, now 80 microseconds is your worst case, because you protected against noise for those ones that might have been longer. So you shortened it a little bit. So if you want to have less constant amount of work, but still slightly under 100, you could go out to 5% of the requests. And depending on what this cumulative distribution function is, it depends on how much you can control the worst case, if it's noise, and what cost you're going to incur through duplicated ones that may or may not be seeing the same problems. All right, but what happens if it's not noise? How do we understand and optimize it when it's not noise? And the rest of my talk is going to talk about how to measure what's in the tail and understand it, and then some optimizations to improve it. And then also how once you want to pack servers together and get really high utilization to do some co-location with some new mechanisms. So one of the important things is the tail is rare. Just like data races are rare, and it's hard to instrument systems to understand the root cause of data races and concurrency bugs in your software, finding the tail and understanding the tail is a hard problem because it's rare. So, and let me just remind you of the server architecture and kind of the complexity of some of these systems. You send a request, goes out over the network, it goes to some aggregator, sends it to some number of workers, and they send it back. And then here's just a very high level and a very simple view of all the software and the hardware stacks that each request goes through. So once you send it from the client application, it goes to the operating system and the network to the aggregator software and operating system on both sides and network. And then it goes through, in the case of Lucene, it's running in a Java virtual machine. So you have the operating system, then the Java virtual machine, and then you actually execute the application code, and then you come back. And all that has to be done super, super fast and super, super predictably. And how do you understand when things are going wrong in that complicated space? So the prior state of the art is I highly recommend this talk by Dick Seitz, which describes how they did this process at Google for the past few years. And so what they did at Google, kind of the state of the art when we started our work, was hand instrument the system using interrupts and take, and they gave themselves a 1% budget at which to understand in the deployed system what was going on. But by sampling, the tails are rare. So a lot of the sample data didn't have what they needed to have in it. So they had to sample for a long time to even get something that was interesting to them. Or do it offline in a test scenario where you miss some of the root causes. And then once they got this information, they would build some schematic like this and have insight and improve the system. And so one of the things that's easy to see here is long arrows between represent long latencies between threads that are communicating. And in this case, they were looking at locks and the locks and the thread execution on the cores. And that's something that you're still going to have to do in whatever system you're working on, is have some deeper analysis of what's going on. And these are complicated systems, so I'm not going to make that so much easier. But I am going to make it easier to find out what's in the tail and how to optimize it. All right, so what we've got is automated instrumentation, so you don't have to go through every single level. The tool is going to instrument everything for you, and we're going to have this 1% budget, and and we're actually quite well under 1%, and so we can do this continuously and online. And then that some of the hard problems we haven't solved, understanding your software system and improving it. And then, but if you can do this continuous, really online, fine grain observation, then you can do online optimizations in the same kind of way. And that's the promise of what we're doing. And since we're just developing it, we haven't gotten to that part yet, so I can't talk about that until we actually do it, hopefully. All right, so our insight is, in terms of building these tools, is that hardware and software are generating signals, and those signals are something that you can observe. And where are those signals stored? Well, the hardware signals are easy. We've all used performance counters. So if you can read your signals out of the hardware performance counters, you can understand what the hardware is doing. But the software also has these same kind of signals, and they're just storing their signals in memory locations. So if you can communicate to your tool which memory location has interesting information in it, such as an interesting a loop identifier or a call path identifier, if that's in your software, if you can identify that, then you can read that signal out without instrumenting the program just by having that memory address. So you have to communicate the memory address at some point, but you do not have to instrument the program to do so. All right, you just have to communicate the address. And then we have two kinds of information we might want: counters, counting up events like instructions per cycle, and tags, something like what method you're in, what loop you're in. And these signals are you can have them in hardware or software too. All right, so our design of our tool is observing inside the same application. You have a thread configured to observe the other thread. So if you're on a multi-core, you need a thread running on another core. And what it's going to do is read the global counter out of the other thread's system and shove it in a buffer. And then, for example, last level cache misses. So the little piece of profiling thread is doing, while true, counter and last level misses and cycles, so you can correlate it to events. And you're just going to shove those in a buffer, all right? And so we can make this extremely low overhead with, but you will consume some memory. So there's some things actually that can be done much better in terms of what hardware support gives us to do this, which I'll leave the details to another day. So you can observe local state as well by using simultaneous multi-threading or what's called hyper-threading on the Intel chips. If you sit on the same core, now you can observe the local any local counters. And so, for example, you can compute the IPC of a thread by taking the core IPC, the IPC of yourself and the observer thread and the IPC of the thing you want to observe, and subtracting them, and that works just the same way by reading these local counters. All right. Unfortunately, right now, if you're running in Intel's hyper-threading mode, you're interfering too much with the other thread. But the other way to do this would be to make those local counters visible on the other core so you can read them out. This has some security implications. But because you're running inside the same application as the you're not a separate process, then you don't need to be protected from the other thread, because this system requires that you're a thread running inside the same process, so you can look at memory locations and hardware counters. And then you can correlate hardware and software events, for example, configuring what method you're in. All right, so just do that and you get some crazy results. All right, so here's measuring IPC with the raw samples that we get from that. And unfortunately, if you just do that and you look at the instructions per cycle, we get something over 10 in several cases. This machine has four-way issues, so that doesn't make sense. All right, so the observer effect is unfortunate, and it's happening. So how can we use that and understand it and control it? All right, so the problem is that taking these samples is not atomic, and so it can take a different amount of time, and that's one source of error that we're seeing. So when you read out the retired instructions and the number of cycles, that takes some small, it should take a very short amount of time, but occasionally it takes a long time, or it takes an even shorter amount of time. And if it doesn't take the same amount of time, this observer, then it's not a good sample. And so we can't compute correctly IPC. But we can notice that it's not that hard to figure out when we have an inconsistent sample. It's when these two sample periods aren't the same amount of time. But measuring them exactly, or measuring the two this way it defeats kind of the purpose. So what we do instead is we measure the interval between the beginning of one period and the beginning of the next period and the end. And those two things should be exactly the same if we have a good sample that they took the same amount of time to sample. And then if that ratio should be one, and when it is one, we say that's a good sample with 1%. We give our, you can control that in our system. And if it's not one, then we throw the sample out. Now if we go back to the leucine example, where we had IPC, and we plot cycles per cycle, that's the raw number that we're getting, we see that that ratio varies wildly, okay? But there's a very high number where that ratio is the same, which is good. That means there are lots of good samples, and this was the cause of the noise. So then if we use that to filter the green samples. So now cycles per cycle is filtered, so it's one with 1%, so we're only using those samples. And then the green line is corrected, all those samples are thrown away. We don't have any crazy high values, although there still could be some observer effects in the low values, but now we at least get numbers that make sense. So we believe that the source of most of the noise was actually from the random effects on the sample period. All right, so then when we do that and we compare to interrupt-driven sample taking, the default for something like DCPI or these other tools that use an interrupt is limited by how fast the operating system can service an interrupt. And so the default, they say, is do this every 1 kilohertz. And the maximum they let you do it is 100 kilohertz. So you can see that IPC doesn't look very interesting for leucine if you're sampling at this very slow rate. But when you can sample really fast, you see a lot of different behavior. And so, for example, you can find the method that has really bad IPC, and you can optimize it if you're looking for what's happening in your data stream. And there's a lot of interesting results from this. All right, so how much overhead does it cost? Well, if you sample just as fast as you possibly can from the other core, you can look at the granularity of 30 cycles. So we can see things that are happening at some granularity that we've never been able to see before on these machines. But unfortunately, the overhead's high, and so there's too much observer effect going on. And that observer effect comes from write-in validations. So if I go read a software location, then the cache says, oh, it's live in another cache, and I'm going to invalidate the written cache line over here, so I have to go get it back when I write it again. So if we had some hardware support for letting us read these memory locations and the hardware performance counters without caching the line, just pushing the value across, then we could get rid of this overhead, because when we slow the sampler down to about 1,000 cycles, then overhead is essentially zero. So we can sample at a rate of about every 1,000 cycles, and we can have 0% overhead. So good. So now let's go back to the real problem we're trying to solve, which is looking at tail latency. All right. So now you take our tool and you configure it to look at thread IDs, performance counters, and timestamps, all of which are available without doing anything at all to your software, all right? But what we want to do is track requests through the system. So we need the operating system and the software to keep track of request IDs. And they already do this because in order to return the request to the correct user, you have to keep track of it through your entire system. So you have to configure each level to tell you where in memory they're storing the request ID. And that's the only change you have to make to your software is communicating that memory address to our tool. And then the system threads have the same thing. And so here's just the highest level version of this, where we're doing queuing time for the inside the scheduler of a worker thread, sending out the requests to and actually starting to execute it. And then the client latency time. So I have latency on the y-axis and request groups from the slowest to the fastest in 1% intervals. So, and that's the maximum request time that we see. And then in each of these 1% groups, and we can basically see now at the server side or at the client side, 100% of the requests, and we can bin them, and we're having no overhead on the existing system. So now if we take the last 1%, now what we're really concerned with is optimizing the tail. So we can see that, and if we're working on lowering the latency of the whole system, we can modify the system. And then using this information. But if we want to understand the tail and optimize the tail, now we can look at each tail request, okay? And this is, in this data, we had 2,000 requests. 200 were in that 100%. So this lays out all the tail requests that we saw in this test data. And it has, and in this case, we've just divided it up into four categories. So the green is good. That means you're actually doing some work on the request. Because we're not doing anything special right now about the network communication and clock skew between the client when it requests a thread and or makes a request and the workers, we have some amount of we don't know if it's the network or clock skew between in this distributed system. So you need to add some logic. There's a good recent paper actually on doing better timing management in a distributed system that I'll point you to if you're interested in. And we can also notice when the thread is idle that it's ready to run, but it's not getting the CPU or because it got descheduled or because it did something like make a miss on a memory I/O request. And then that red is queuing at the worker, which is bad, which is you either had a burst of requests that were a problem or that you couldn't handle, or you have some unscalable data structure. All right, so one thing I want to point out is for almost the top 50% of these requests, there's a lot of green, and that's not noise. That's real work that your system is doing. So to optimize that, I'm going to show you a new form of parallelism for interactive services, and then we also need to optimize the noise or understand if it is noise over there. And so I'm going to show you what we found in that work as well. So, but first, let's say, okay, a big majority of this tail for this system is work. What do we do to optimize work? We introduce parallelism. Well, parallelism has historically been used in these distributed systems for throughput. And in a search system, what's limiting you is how much of the index that you can keep on one machine. And then you want to max, then you send a query, and then you don't know how much many hits you're going to get on that part of the index space when you start the query. But because you want to keep the overheads just as low as possible, when in queuing theory tells us we should just do one request at a time because then we'll maximize throughput of the machine and we won't have any overhead due to parallelizing individual requests. So our idea is, hey, though, that you've got tail latency, one way to bring it down is to add parallelism. And our insight is that So if you just do that, though, you're going to have some problems. So I'll show you if, say, let's take every request and make it parallel, and then we compare that to sequential execution time. And hey, it works great at low requests per second, but at highest load, it didn't push us out any further. In fact, it degraded tail latency faster at higher load because it overwhelms the machine. So this parallelism is good at reducing the latency, but it's bad at the very tail. It doesn't catch that. And so what can we do to manage that is that the good thing, just like I showed you earlier in the talk, when we when we've got noise, that long requests are revealing themselves as you execute. Well, you can use that same principle here to introduce parallelism. So because long requests reveal themselves, for a little while we can run this sequentially, and then if it's not finished, then we can add parallelism then and accelerate it as we go. And we can use that cumulative distribution function to explore the optimization space for how to do this correctly. And for the purposes of this talk, which says I've elapsed an hour. Have I talked for an hour already? What? Okay, awesome. If I was already over, I was in trouble. All right, so here we're going to incrementally add parallelism to these long requests, the tail, and we're going to do it based on their progress and on their load, all right? And we call this few-to-many dynamic parallelism, and if you're interested in the details of the algorithm, you can see our paper. But just to give you a quick idea, some request comes in. It executes, it doesn't have to execute for very long in the case that the machine is very lightly loaded, and we'll give it some parallelism right away. But then as more requests are on the machine, we wait a little longer, then we give it some, and then those short requests leave, or maybe we have another one in, and then we're reacting to the both the load and the latency of the particular request we're working on. And then that gives great results. It pushes you out so that that you can reduce the tail latency, and it lets you have more, or you could just buy fewer servers this way because you're pushing out the request per second that this can handle, and so you could offer the same tail latency if you've already engineered your system at some rate, or you could pick somewhere in between managing how much load this machine can handle now. And that the idea behind that is that the queuing theory has told us that this average latency is going to maximize throughput. But if we're looking at the tail, we can actually sacrifice a little bit of average performance to shorten the tail, and that will give us a better performance point and actually let us do more requests per second. And this, if every request took exactly the same amount of time, this wouldn't work, right? Because you can't sacrifice any request for any other one. But because of the heterogeneity in the request demand, we get this leverage. And the other thing I want to add is those long requests can muck up a lot of stuff because they can be consuming a resource for a long time and they can cause queuing delay. So by getting them out of your system faster, by adding parallelism to them, you actually improve responsiveness that way as well, which is how you gets to push you out on that demand curve that I showed in the previous slide. All right, so yay, we solved that problem. But what about this problem, all right? Because there is a lot of a queuing delay here at the worker. We get a request, we're not able to put it out. Why is that happening? And so in a very simplified version of the Google timeline, I'm going to show you a timeline and just the kind of thing that you can see once you have this kind of data. So here, You can keep track of what's happening, and you can, and this has cannot be done online. It does have to be done offline, combining the data from the end user's requests and what's on the aggregator and what's on the workers post facto. So here, we keep track of the CPU threads and what they're doing, and then I'm only showing one thread, but the power of this profiling approach is you can look at multiple threads, and so you can find, oh, I want this time period when all these threads were experiencing a queuing delay, all right? And so I'm just showing one here. And in one case, one of the things we found is that the GC thread was stopping all the cores while it did some GC, and that caused a bunch of queuing delay in the requests, and then they're you could have a concurrent GC, but that offers a trade-off that's too high in overhead right now. And so one of the simple things we did to solve this was just have two virtual machines running. Because this is a stateless server, you can send requests. If one starts doing GC, you can start sending requests to the other one, and they can share the resources. And so that was one fix that we had for this. But in your system, when you're optimizing it, you would find different problems. If you were working on a C server, you wouldn't see GC as your main problem. You'd see other queuing delay. And when we look, some of our results on memcached were exactly were queuing delay again, but at the OS layer to the memory controller. The memory controller was, or the network controller was getting so many requests per second, and the OS wasn't scaling in spreading out those requests to all the cores. So we had idle cores, but requests sitting in the network controller that weren't getting spit out to these idle cores quickly enough. So that's kind of the methodology and the kinds of things that we're able to see. So this, to recap just a little bit, we've now got a cycle level accurate tool with extremely low overheads that lets us observe rare events and get deep information about them, but yet not be paying a lot of overhead. And that continuous observation lets you see things faster because you don't have to sample and because you get to correlate across time much more easily. So, but that's still not good enough because we need to, because queuing theory is still dominating us a little bit here because we're still getting bursty workloads. And we're not able to schedule these cores as, or these servers as highly as we want to. And because we're over-provisioning for these maximum bursts and queuing delay is degrading both the average and the tail in this case. And so Luis Barsaro Holtz in their book said that these kinds of servers are at 10 to 50% utilization on average because of this over-provisioning. And so I'm just going to give you an example of what happens with Lucene when you hit a burst, a high workload, and let's say our SLO is 100 milliseconds, and then when you hit that SLO, you're at 67%, and so you'd never want to run out there at that request per second because you'd hit your tail too often. You'd need to run lower. But if you think about these machines, they're not just one core machines. They have hyperthreading. We talked about hyperthreading earlier and how we might be able to use it for profiling. We saw some interference. But here, we might be able to use it for requests. And why aren't we using it for requests? So if you consider that you've got two hardware contexts there, even when you're running at the most you can, it's actually only 34% at very high utilization. All right. So why can't we soak up the slack with batch workloads? Well, what the current state of the art is that if you have this latency, and I'm using green again to be my latency critical workload for Lucene, and let's pretend for now the blue is Hadoop, some batch workload. So right now, because we might have a latency critical workload arrive quickly, we keep an idle core, all right? And that means always when that latency critical request comes in, we can put our request on that. And if we don't have enough idle, we stop running the batch. And if you think about that in term, and we don't have a fine-grained mechanism for ripping the batch workload off and putting the latency critical. So the OS isn't responsive enough still to do that quickly. And so here, if you think about that in terms of SMT, you're not using very much hardware. So I'm going to show you how to fully use the unutilized hardware and alternate so that that latency critical request can when it shows up, the you stop working, and when it's there, you're not doing the batch. And that's the basic idea. And so I'm going to remind you of how SMT works, since now it's late to have done that, but since I've talked about it a couple times. So if we just do nothing in the other loop and we interfere, thank you so much, and we interfere with the Lucene alone is the black line here, and then the red line is running Lucene together with this while one, which is basically doing nothing. It shouldn't take up that more resources, but it destroys the tail latency of Lucene to do that. And even if I do a memory fence and wait for a while and try to do nothing, it still degrades Lucene's latency quite a bit. And the reason is because there's static partitioning in the hardware of the SMT, but on the other hand, we're getting great utilization of the core. It can run at this rate. So how can we get some of that back? So when you have simultaneous multi-threading off, you get the core to yourself. When you have it on, you have to share issue slots, and you have to share the load store queue. Right now, on the Intel hardware, those two structures are statically partitioned, and the functional units are dynamically shared. So one thing you could do is you could make SMT hardware more dynamic, and then you would interfere less, but that has a high hardware cost, but that might be worth it. And that, because right now it's not working well enough, it's degrading in this circumstance. So the idea for us is to do what we call principled borrowing, like the elfin shoemaker, if you know that children's story. So while the shoemaker was asleep, the elves at night would get up and help him and make shoes. So when the latency critical workload is running, as I showed earlier, there are many short requests. So it runs, and then you get another request, and then you get another request. So you need to be able to react at a very fine granularity in order to share a core with a latency critical request, so that as soon as it comes in, it gets the core, and you need to be able to deschedule yourself very quickly and use very small units of compute that are made available to you if you're going to share the same core. So the idea is to fill these idle cycles up with that batch workload and to switch quickly between them. So in this case, the hardware has the right features, but the operating system doesn't. So the hardware, you can call mWait, and mWait says, I'm the blue thread, the green thread shows up, I need to do an mWait, and I'll deschedule myself. But the operating says, ooh, I want to run at higher utilization. Here's this red thread, I'm going to swap it in instead, because you paused, I'm going to use your hardware context. So what we're going to do instead is we want the hardware to sleep so that it gives all the resources to the latency critical thread. So we need a new system call. We call this system call NanoNap, and it's kind of anathema to operating systems to say, I'm still using this core, but I'm not doing anything, and you have to let me keep using it. All right? So this NanoNap, the kernel's still in control because we're going to enable and disable interrupts. So if you schedule another thread instead, it needs to have this same, it needs to also do a NanoNap. But until it gets descheduled, it's saying, I'm sleeping. So that gives up its hardware resources, and it uses a flag, and the OS knows about that flag, and the OS can wake that thread up by setting the flag. And I'll show you how we do that in a second. All right, so the latency critical threads have no change at all. They look great. But what we're going to do is instrument the batch workloads so that they're checking their neighbor core all the time. So there's a hardware performance counter that says whether someone is running in the core adjacent to you, and you can check that. And so we insert this little piece of code that says, is anybody running there? And then we bind the latency critical threads are only allowed to run, say, in the even cores, and the batch workloads run in the odd cores. So when the batch workload starts running, nothing is running on the other core, but it's continuously checking this lane status. So you have to either use dynamic instrumentation or compile time instrumentation to say, if the request lane is idle, I can keep executing. But if it's not, I'm going to go down the slow path. And the slow path is take a nap, all right? Release the hardware resources. And then the latency critical workload starts running. And then it gets the core the whole time. And then the OS deschedules the latency critical thread, and it touches the flag, and now the batch workload can run again. And so this lets us at extremely low latency of the order of 1 to 3,000 cycles to switch between the threads. And Doug Carmine, who was the designer of the M-weight, says it should be able to go even faster, but I guess there's some latency built in there that he thinks that this should be able to happen in hundreds of cycles rather than 1,000, but that's what we're getting. But even the 1,000 cycles is enough to show no perceptible overhead. So these graphs are showing 99% latency on the y-axis, and that black line is still Lucene working on its own, and the blue line is Lucene running together on one core, in this case, with each of these DiCapo benchmarks, which are big memory-hungry and messy large programs, and switching back and forth. And then these results are on 7 cores with SMT lanes. And so you can see when we get up to high requests per cycle over there on the far right, that we get more variation in the tail, that there's a higher variation. So probably you don't want to run the machine at that highly loaded, but that you can push, that you can essentially have 100% utilization or 1% utilization out of 2 if you are running it all at the same time. And then we also, we've been able to bump this up a little further even by a new OS mechanism so that we can quickly deschedule and schedule using the OS, and then we don't have to use any, we don't have to instrument the batch program either. So coming back, where am I on time at this point? Yes. Okay. So we can see that specialization is coming in our hardware. Microsoft is shipping FPGAs in the data centers. Google's shipping ASICs specialized hardware for these top workloads, and this is becoming a reality. To work on top of that, the software has to be able to understand. You need tools. You're still going to need tools like we have. And so for both architects and software, we have an interesting time. If we go back and look at our basic CDF, we have a heterogeneous workload. It should map very well to this heterogeneous hardware. And we have a few results on that I'm going to skip over. But this is a complexity challenge. The heterogeneous hardware to make it composable and transparent to much of the software is going to take a lot more work on the software side, but this efficiency opportunity is very high. So I thank you. It's really been a pleasure to talk to you. And now please ask me questions.